So there's one more thing we need to do with U-substitution, and that's to figure out how to use it with definite integrals. There's actually two ways to use U-substitution with definite integrals. The first is to remember that a definite integral is going to be any antiderivative of b minus any antiderivative of a. So in this problem, we're going to use this fact, and we're just going to find capital F of x, which is the indefinite integral of our function. And then once we found capital F of x, we'll use it to solve this integral. So this integral looks really, really difficult. We have 2 to the x natural log of 2 plus 1 all times the square root of 2x plus x. But one of the things when you're looking to do U-substitution with integrals to notice is, where do you have an outside function where you know how to take its integral if it was just a plain x inside, but instead you have something complicated like 2 to the x plus x? If you need that thing to be a plain x or a plain u, we'll try it and see if it works. U equals 2 to the x plus x. Another thing I should say about U-substitution is sometimes you try u equals something and you can't make it work. But that doesn't mean that U-substitution isn't the way to solve the problem. You might just have to pick a different value for u. So in this case, we're going to let u equal 2 to the x plus x, and take the derivative and see what it is. See if we have anything that matches it. So the derivative of 2 to the x is 2 to the x times the natural log of 2. And the derivative of x is 1. So we have 2 to the x natural log of 2 plus 1, the whole thing, times du. Well, hey, look at that. That's exactly what we have here, right? Here's 2 to the x natural log of 2 plus 1 times dx. So that whole thing is just going to become du. And the inside of the square root becomes our u. So our new integral is square root of u du, which remember is u to the 1 half du. So the antiderivative of that is u to the 3 halves over 3 halves plus c. Going back to x's, we get 2 thirds quantity of 2 to the x plus x to the 3 halves plus c. So this is our general antiderivative. So if we want one specific antiderivative, we can take capital F of x to equal 2 thirds 2 to the x plus x to the 3 halves. There's one specific antiderivative. And then if we want to find the integral from 0 to 1 of 2 to the x ln of 2 plus 1 times the square root of 2 to the x plus x dx, well, we found a general antiderivative of that. So we can say that the definite integral is, like we said before, capital F of 1 minus capital F of 0. So using our capital F now, get 2 thirds 2 to the 1 plus 1 to the 3 halves minus 2 thirds 2 to the 0 plus 0 to the 3 halves, which we can simplify a little bit to be 2 thirds 3 halves minus 2 thirds times 1 to the 3 halves, which is just 1. So that's our answer to the definite integral. So the technique here was to find the indefinite integral and then just use it with the second fundamental theorem of calculus to get our answer. There's another slightly quicker way, though, that we can do U-substitution for definite integrals. Let's try the quicker way on this problem. So in this problem, again, we have x plus 1 times the quantity x squared plus 2x plus 2 to the 43rd. The 43rd power means I really, really don't want to FOIL this out. So I really would like everything inside of it to just be a single variable. So let's hope that if we let u equals x squared plus 2x plus 2, we can find a way to finagle it so that we have the du. So we take the derivative, we get du equals 2x plus 2 dx, and we have an x plus 1 dx left over in our problem. We're looking for 2x plus 2 dx. So notice the difference here is just a factor of 2. So if we factor out a 2, we can get du equals 2 times x plus 1 dx, and dividing that 2 over, we get du over 2 equals x plus 1 dx. So now we can take the x plus 1 and the dx, and together we can call these du over 2. And of course this inside, we're calling u. So our new integral is the integral of u to the 43rd times du over 2. But the real question is, what do we do with these limits of integration? I told you there was a quicker way than solving the problem entirely without the limits and then going back to x and then plugging the limits back in. And that quicker way is to actually convert these to u values. So these are x values. This negative 1 and 1 actually means that x equals 1 and x equals negative 1. We start taking the area when x equals negative 1 and we stop when x equals 1. So can I change those x's to u values? I can. Again, I'm going to go back to my main equation for the substitution, what I've set u equal to. Now here, u is actually a function of x. So I can plug in u of negative 1 and get negative 1 squared plus 2 times negative 1 plus 2, which is 1. So my new bottom limit is 1. And I can do u of 1, which is 1 squared plus 2 times 1 plus 2, so that's 5. So my new top limit is 5. So what this means is, when x is negative 1, u is 1, and when x is 1, u is 5. So now I have a new integral, a new definite integral, that's entirely in terms of u, and doesn't have anything to do with x. So when I do the problem this way, I never need to go back to x. In fact, I never need to remember the original problem at all. I can just do this new problem. So if I do this new problem, I can pull the 1 half out front. The integral from 1 to 5 of u to the 43rd du. And then I just use the power rule. This becomes u to the 44th over 44. Evaluated from 1 to 5, and I still have a 1 half out front. So using the second fundamental theorem of calculus, I get 1 over 88 times 5 to the 44th minus 1 to the 44th. And that's my answer. So I didn't have to go back to x's at all. So when doing definite integrals with u-substitution, you have two choices. You can not change the limits of integration, do the indefinite integral, go back to x's, and then when you're finally done, evaluate the definite integral from your indefinite integral. Or, the quicker way, is you can turn everything into u's, the function, the dx, and even the limits of integration. And when you do that, you can forget about the original problem and just solve the new integral.
The last thing to point out is that even though we're calling these two different methods, they're actually the same. When you don't change the limits of integration, you find f of u of x, and you evaluate it from a to b. So you get capital F of u of b minus capital F of u of a, just like when you switch the limits of integration to u values at the beginning and you end up plugging in u of a into capital F and u of b into capital F. Both ways you end up with the same formula.